Hello, everyone. Welcome to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson, and today we are going to be looking at a viewer question dealing with how to measure trace impedance using a VNA. Now, if you're familiar with vector network analyzers or VNAs, you probably know that impedance measurements are not something that you measure directly. It's actually a comparative measurement. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at this viewer question. We're going to look at some of the concepts involved in using a VNA and getting S parameters to determine impedance, and then we're going to do a demo with a LibreVNA using a test board. So let's go ahead and get started. So before we get started, let's take a look at that viewer question. Jebin Kumar writes, "Hi Zach, I'm a super fan of your videos. I was wondering if it's possible to measure the PCB trace impedance, i.e. 50 ohms, using a VNA." The way we measure PCB trace impedance is by using S parameters, and specifically we want to use S11 as our S parameter for determining impedance. Now, if we want to look at the impedance coming from the other port in a two-port network, we would use S22. And of course, we could extend this all the way up to any number of ports on our device under test. Now, one important thing to note about S11 or S22 or in general SNN measurements is that they are all comparative measurements. You are actually not measuring the impedance directly. What you're doing is you're looking at the amount of electromagnetic energy that is reflected from one of these ports, and you know that the amount of reflected energy is proportional to the difference in the impedances between the port impedance and the device under test. So really what you're doing is you're comparing two impedances. And what you're doing is you're comparing the impedance of the device under test, in this case a transmission line, with some reference impedance that we'll call Zref. So this Zref is usually set to, of course, 50 ohms. Sometimes in a 70 or 75 ohm system, it's going to be set differently, but generally it's set to 50 ohms. And so what you're doing is you are comparing the electromagnetic wave energy that is reflected from your impedance of your device under test at the interface with a 50 ohm reference. So in order to do this, we have to calibrate our instrument against a 50 ohm reference. So in this demo, we're going to use a LibreVNA, and of course, it's a low cost instrument. It's a little bit of a toy, but we could still get some measurements from it, and it's going to be very useful for actually looking at an interpretation of this data. However, when you're in a professional setting, you'll probably use a much more expensive VNA, and at the moment, I of course don't have one in the lab, but the same concepts are going to apply. When we're doing one of these measurements, what do we expect to see? So I think that's the first thing to note whenever you're going to do some kind of measurement, is to think about what do you expect to see in that measurement. So let's examine S11 and see what we will expect from our VNA measurements, and then we can actually interpret what's going on with that impedance that we're trying to measure. So this is the basic topology of a two-port measurement, and what we have here is we have our device under test. Remember, in this case, it is a transmission line. We want to then measure Z sub zero, which is the characteristic impedance of that line. And then we have a reference impedance at our other port. And we also have a reference impedance here looking into the device under test, and it's generally the same value at both ports. So in this case, equal to 50 ohms. When we send in the signal from port one going into the device under test via the reference impedance, what do we expect to measure? Well, remember here that Z sub zero can vary over frequency. So here there is a reflection coefficient looking into this portion of the topology, and this reflection coefficient is equal to the input impedance minus the reference impedance divided by Z in plus the reference impedance. So this value for Zin is what really defines the value of S11. And remember that Zin is proportional to a hyperbolic tangent function involving the propagation constant and the length of this transmission line. So this is really important because this hyperbolic tangent function is what's going to give the S11 curve its very characteristic shape. So it depends on this propagation constant and the length of the transmission line. So what can we expect from a graph of reflection coefficient or a graph of S11 if we then plot this out over frequency? Well, what I'll do right now is just draw out a graph that you might expect. So if we were to look at, for example, S11, and we were to plot this out over frequency, we would see different things depending on the length of this transmission line. If we had a relatively short transmission line, eventually we would have our S11 value start here, and then as we get up to higher frequency, we might see a pretty big dip here corresponding to very perfect matching seen at this port. It will start to do this type of behavior, going off into higher frequencies. And it looks something like this. But then, if we were to then say, measure a longer line, we would actually then see something that looks kind of like this, where we get more of these humps, and then the humps move back to lower frequency. So the length of our interconnects leading over to the DUT, as well as the propagation constant for the waves traveling through this circuit, really determine the shape of this S11 curve. And so using this, and then using a value for the propagation constant, you could then calculate what Z0 is. Remember, you need the propagation constant. Well, how do you get the propagation constant? Well, you can actually do that by taking a measurement of S21. So S21 is proportional to the exponential of negative propagation constant times the length of the interconnect. So S21 can also be used to then get the propagation constant, plug that back in here, and then you can extract the impedance. Now, there are actually much more sophisticated methods that are used to extract circuit parameters for a transmission line, as well as to extract the impedance of the transmission line directly from S parameter measurements. So that's going to be a topic for another video. But for now, we just want to look at doing the specific measurements and then show what you can expect to see from a VNA measurement, and then interpret that and understand what is the impedance of the system that you're trying to measure. So now that we know a little bit about what we would expect to see if we're trying to measure the impedance of a transmission line, let's jump onto the VNA and look at an example. What we're going to do in this example is we're going to measure a test board. And this small test board has a transmission line design on it, and it has a couple of connectors that are then connected to the ends of the transmission line. Now, in order to do this type of measurement properly, you have to notice here that we actually have two other circuit elements that really determine the impedance looking into this interconnect. Because it's not just the DUT, it's actually also a connector right here, and then a connector right here. So you have to also know whether or not these connectors contribute to the impedance that you're trying to measure. And as you get to successively higher frequencies, those connectors really do matter, and you use a procedure called de-embedding to pull out just the S parameters for this device under test. So that effectively isolates this transmission line from any connectors as well as any other interconnect lines going from the instrument to the device. So here I have the LibreVNA GUI brought up. We have all four S parameters for a two-port network being plotted on screen. This also does a Smith chart for one of the ports if you want. Here, I'm not going to worry about that. I just want to focus on S11 and S21 right now. But of course, you could do all the stuff that we're doing here and plot this for S12 and S22. Let's just hook up our test piece. When I hook everything up and bring this over to port 2, you can see here what our S parameters look like, and specifically what S11 looks like. S11 and S21 would really need to be used together to get the impedance of that trace. S21 would be used to get the propagation constant. You would use that in S11 to figure out the characteristic impedance. Of course, here you can see that our characteristic impedance is pretty good with a match to 50 ohms. You can see here that we have negative 20 dB up to reasonably high frequency, and then we get up to negative 10 dB. Now, the negative 10 dB limit that you see here is pretty often taken as an acceptable limit on impedance matching. So when you get above that negative 10 dB limit, it's considered to be not so good impedance matching anymore. Now, this negative 10 dB limit is, of course, kind of arbitrary. Really, the value that matters depends on your particular signaling standard, but generally, negative 10 dB seen as a good value. Now, the other thing that you see here in this S11 plot is you can see pretty clearly that we have these ripples here. And so these ripples are separated by what looks like about 300 megahertz. So right here, we have 2.429 gigahertz. And then this other one back here, we have right at about 2.121 gigahertz. So that characteristic rippling results from the fact that we're really measuring the input impedance looking into that trace or that transmission line. What would happen if I were to say, unplug this and then increase the length of the line going from port one over to my test board? What would that look like? Well, as we saw on the whiteboard, if we were to increase the length of that line, we would expect the ripples to come closer together, and then we would expect them to appear a little bit earlier in frequency. So if I just make this connection and screw this in, we can see that they do start to get strong a bit earlier in frequency. And then also we see that we get about half of the frequency separation between these valleys in the S11 plot. So I can bring this up full screen. So you can see here that the distance between these points is about 150 megahertz, so just about half. So that's pretty much what you would expect if you were to double the line length leading from one of your output ports on your VNA to the input port on your test piece. So that's exactly what we would expect. Next, let's go back to the S21 spectrum. So here in the S21 spectrum, if you just compare this with the earlier measurement, you can see here that our phase plot is also compressed, just like we see in the S11 plot. And then you can see here, we start to see those same characteristic ripples that we find in the S11 plot telegraphed over to the S21 plot, and they have the exact same frequency separation. So here we're at 4.2 gigahertz at this minimum, and then here we're at about 4.04 gigahertz at this minimum. So that's about 150 megahertz separation. So that's pretty good. So now that we have all of this data from these measurements, what frequency range should we use or take as an acceptable frequency range for our S parameter measurements, and then use that to determine the impedance spectrum? Well, that really depends. And one of the things it depends on is the frequency rating for your particular test standards. So the LibreVNA is supplied with a set of test standards. I don't know the frequency range over which they're accurate, but if you know that band limit or that frequency limit up to where they're considered accurate, then you can use that frequency limit to determine the allowed range where you should analyze your S parameters and then extract the impedance. Here, what I would advise on this particular line is to look at the range where you just start to see this rippling in the frequency domain. So that would be right up to about 2.4 gigahertz. So from 0 to 2.4 gigahertz, you could use that to extract the propagation constant, and then you could use that to figure out the impedance from 0 to 2.4 gigahertz for this S11 curve. Once you have that, you basically know the input impedance, and then from the input impedance, you can calculate the characteristic impedance just using the input impedance formula from transmission line theory. Now that we've gotten some measurements with the LibreVNA, I think it's always good to just do a quick sanity check in a simulator to make sure that the results are within the range, roughly within the range that you expect. So what I've done is I've done an export to ODB++. I'm gonna take this into Symbior, and we'll do a quick S parameter simulation just so that we can get the S11 S parameter, and we can see how that varies over frequency. So here I just need to select this one net. We'll do a quick ERC, and then we will do a fast SI simulation, extract that, and then we can get the S parameters pretty quickly. So here is our return loss, and as we can see, it's pretty good all the way up to the frequency range we care about, which is 6 gigahertz, and well beyond that. So you can see here we're pretty far below that negative 10 dB, and we're even pretty far below negative 20 dB, so that's pretty good. So I think this is a good indicator that our test board is going to work out once we put it into measurement, and that is exactly what we saw on the LibreVNA. So this is all jiving, and that's exactly what we would hope for. If we wanted to do some more work with this or get even more detailed, we could, of course, do a 3D simulation. We can do that here in Symbior, or you can take this into another more advanced program like ANSYS, and then you could also do a 3D simulation of the board, and you can probably get some more detail as far as the S parameters are concerned. Here with the insertion loss, we see kind of the same results. It's not as discretized as I would like, just because I use the default settings, but you can see here, once we get to these higher frequencies, we start to see the corresponding waviness in the insertion loss plot compared to what we we had on the LibreVNA. So we also saw a little bit of that waviness once we started to get up into higher frequencies. And that, of course, occurs both due to the increase in the return loss as you get to these high frequencies, as well as some dispersion along the length of the interconnect. Now, as I mentioned before, once you get that data from either the measurements or the simulations, you can then put that back into, for example, a circuit extraction technique. So take a look at the video that's in the description. It goes over some of the theory behind circuit extraction. And unfortunately, circuit extraction is a little bit involved. I created a spreadsheet that kind of guides you through it in, you know, a hand-wavy way using an optimization algorithm. It's a bit more advanced than that, and you need a tool like ADS or like Symbior in order to do that extraction. Now, if we just go back over here to ERC, and then we run this really quick, we can see here what the trace impedance is for this interconnect. We can see it comes out to 48.4 ohms. So of course, a simulator can tell you that really quickly, or you could also just input this data into its circuit extraction tool, and it will extract all of the transmission line parameters as well as the impedance. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. This should give you the fundamental understanding that you will need to use a much more powerful VNA than the LibreVNA. Of course, the LibreVNA is an inexpensive test instrument that we like to use for demos around here, and it's fun to play with, but when you're in a professional setting, you're gonna be working at much higher frequencies with a much more expensive piece of equipment. So make sure to keep these concepts in mind when you're interpreting your S parameters from more powerful VNA measurements. Make sure to hit that subscribe button, hit the like button, leave your questions and comments in the comment section, and of course, if you leave the right question, we might make a video out of it. And last but not least, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks.